Blackstone Audio presents Negotiator, The Life and Career of James B. Donovan by Philip J. Bigger. This book is read by Robertson Dean. For Mary Donovan Bush. My candle burns at both ends. It will not last the night. But ah, my foes, and oh, my friends, it gives a lovely light. Edna St. Vincent Millay. First Fig. Preface. It was clear and 81 degrees in Cuba on December 23, 1962. At San Antonio de los Baños Airport, outside of Havana, two men stood side by side on a platform near the tarmac, watching a Pan Am flight board. One was the young Fidel Castro, 35 years old and now the premier of Cuba, a tall, patrician man dressed in crisp military fatigues. His now famous beard, a feature that he had adopted during his stay in the Sierra Madre Mountains at the start of his revolution, was full but neatly trimmed. Next to him was a New York lawyer, James B. Donovan, 11 years Castro's senior. He was shorter and stockier, with thinning gray hair, but his steel blue eyes were piercing and alive. Both men had been negotiating for months to secure the release of the soldiers captured by Castro's forces following the ill-fated Bay of Pigs invasion in April 1961. The talks were nearly completed, and now some of the prisoners were boarding planes bound for Florida and freedom. Sharing the platform with Donovan and Castro were several aides and assistants of each, on hand to witness this momentous occasion. There were also numerous Cuban soldiers. Despite the success of the talks, there remained a deep feeling among Castro's military advisors that the United States might still try to launch an attack on Cuba, and Donovan was, at times, likened to the Japanese peace envoys in Washington at the time of the strike on Pearl Harbor. As the group watched the prisoner-laden planes take off, several Cuban pilots who were circling the airport in Russian-built MiGs sought to salute their commander. One flew in over the platform at an exceptionally low altitude, causing both the Americans and Cubans, including Castro and Donovan, to fall to their knees in panic. When someone near Castro asked, "What was that?" Donovan quickly yelled to Castro, "It's the invasion!" Castro roared loudly with delight. His soldiers, though offended with the remark, joined with their leader in laughter. It was Donovan's characteristic quick wit, and it helped to break the tension of the moment, as he had done so often during his negotiations with the Cuban leader. Castro had been completely taken in by Donovan's boldness, charm, humor, and integrity. The successful culmination of negotiations with Fidel Castro was a high watermark in Cuban-American relations, one that has not been replicated since. For Donovan himself, it was only one episode in a career of service that had begun in earnest in the early 1940s. James Donovan was reared in a conservative Irish Catholic home where concepts of family, religion, educational attainment, and patriotism were key essentials, and he lived up to all of them. The United States had entered World War II little more than a year after Donovan completed his legal education at Harvard University. By this time, a significant government agency had been created, the Office of Scientific Research and Development, OSRD. Under the leadership of Vannevar Bush, its goal was to foster development of new weapons, not the least of which was the atomic bomb, as well as new medicines for the military. Donovan was hired as a civilian attorney for the organization and quickly rose to the position of general counsel. In that capacity, he was not only called upon to review military contracts with universities and write opinions on such topics as the legality of using civilian prisoners in potentially fatal military experiments, but also to participate in arranging public lands for atomic experiments. Shortly after the creation of the OSRD in 1942, a new intelligence agency was established, the Office of Strategic Services, OSS, forerunner of the Central Intelligence Agency. Having by then received a commission in the Navy, Donovan left the Office of Scientific Research and Development and was detailed to the OSS. Toward the conclusion of the war, he was designated Chief of the War Crimes Unit within the OSS and given the responsibility for overseeing the collection and organization of data concerning Nazi atrocities. It was a smooth transition for him then, after Germany surrendered, to fill the role of one of the prosecutors at the First War Crimes Unit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.